Before introducing our first tutorial speaker today, I'd like to just make two quick announcements. One is about this slot in the program, which some of you felt it was a bit unusual. The name of it is Free Session, and I've been asked to explain what that means. It means whatever you like. I mean, it means that we had it last year, and it was by chance, actually. And it turned out to be extremely productive. People just sat in this room and started working and chatting. And, you know, you never have time to do those things in conferences. So we thought this year we would just design an empty slot for that. So, which doesn't mean you can't go and get your canonical tower picture, if you like. But the idea is that maybe we'll be all in this room. Anyway, this room will be open, and you know, we'll be acting as if it's a conference, a workshop session. So that's the free session thing, and we have a little extra after the last tutorial today, and it's going to be, you know, technology permitting, a just quick hello from Fabio, who's in Milano and couldn't make it here. So we just, everything is set up now. Of course, it's not going to work, but we hope it will. And that's the two small announcements. So my big pleasure to introduce our first tutorial speaker for today, Pierpaolo, who's going to talk about monetary policies in some confirming equilibria with uncertain models, which is a bit longer than the title we have in the program, but I suppose it's just the same talk. Thank you very much, Pierpaolo.
Yes, thank you. Now, this is the title of a paper we are working on. The title of the tutorial is shorter. Basically, I will say both, you know, more general things and illustrate them with material from this paper, which is co-author with Ceria Vioglio, Maccheroni, Marinacci, and Thomas Sargent. Okay, so let's say that monetary policies are the illustrating application, okay, but I will start with generalities. So now we have seen what we mean by uncertainty. It means that the decision maker faces multiple probabilistic models, such as there are multiple possible earths from which the ball is drawn. The decision maker doesn't know the content of the urn. And this implies that some acts induce lotteries with uncertain probabilities. Now, you know, in the last couple of days, we have seen that this may induce action tendencies in the decision maker to avoid acts that give rise to uncertain distributions of consequences. This is called uncertainty aversion or ambiguity aversion. Well, it will turn out that in the application considered here, this is completely irrelevant. So I will not take this aspect into account. So another feature, what I'm going to do is that there is imperfect observation of state realizations. And when I say state, I also have in mind application to games, where the state is the strategy of the other player, or the strategy profile of other players. Okay? So this is an application to decision problems, but it easily extends to game. So this imperfect observation is given by information feedback. And the key issue is that information feedback depends on the chosen action. Now, if you think, you know, what is the information for once the action has been chosen, the idea is that we are going to study stationary environments where the, you know, the decision maker choose time and again, and therefore, you know, what you observe about last time is useful to assess the probability of states next time. Anyway, this imperfect feedback gives rise to a partial identification problem because there are many state distributions which are consistent with the empirical frequencies of observed data given the choice that the decision maker is making in the long run. And I will give a formal definition of a self-confirming equilibrium choice as in a recurrent decision problem as something that captures the stochastic steady state, where the choice is optimal given subjective beliefs about the stochastic model, subjective beliefs about you know, the proportions of balls of different colors in the urn. And these beliefs must be consistent with the empirical frequencies of observations. And again, observations are not directly about the state. Okay, so why is this relevant for policymaking, like in this paper? Well, we have seen already an illustration of this with the presentation by Elie Sartori. So the policymaker using a self-confirming equilibrium policy has learned the distribution of consequences of the chosen policy, the policies that the policymaker is implementing in the long run. But in general, he has not learned the data generating process or the model, the underlying model economy. And so, for example, and this will be illustrated here, a policymaker may believe in steady state that there is a long-run trade-off between inflation and unemployment, even if no such long-run trade-off exists. Okay, so this is, I mean, there are many more papers that are related to what I'm saying, but the, you know, the most related literature for the self-confirming equilibrium concept, you know, there are a couple of surveys, and then there is a literature review in an older paper of others, and the application is most related to a book by Sargent called The Conquest of American Inflation, and a more recent paper, which is kind of methodological, called Evolution and Intelligent Design. Okay. So this is the framework. There is a recurrent decision problem, and the feedback I am assuming here, although it is not the most general assumption, I'm assuming that the feedback is given by observed consequences. I will not insist very much on all the mathematical properties required so that everything makes sense. Anyway, to say the least, with all the sets that you're going to see here are going to be Polish spaces, okay? For many things, you know, at least, you know, you are going to see a preliminary example where action spaces, state space, consequence space are all finite, but for the macroeconomic application, we will consider infinite spaces. So what is this, how do we represent feedback? Well, since I'm assuming that what is observed are the consequences, okay, the feedback is actually the consequence function, okay? So it is a function that assigns to each action state pair a consequence. Although we could consider, you know, a more general specification of the feedback function. Then we assume that attitudes toward risk and the value of consequences are captured by a von Neumann-Morgenstern utility function. Okay, so the state of nature is determined at random, and you know, in the background, the interpretation is that we have an IID process, really. Okay, so it is determined at random according to an unknown but objective probability measure sigma, and there is a, you know, a posited set of possible objective probability measures or possible stochastic models. In some applications, like, you know, the main application we are going to consider, the set of stochastic model can be parameterized by some parameter vectors. We know this in statistics, you can parameterize, you know, you have the set of Gaussian distribution that you can parameterize with mean and volatility, for example, okay? Another feature that we are going to have in the application is that actually the state of nature is given by the parameter and some shock, okay? So there is a permanent component of the state of nature, which we call theta, and the random component, okay? Okay, so information feedback. So we have this, you know, consequence function, and we consider, when we consider a fixed action, then we can consider the section of the consequence function at this action, F subscript A, okay, which is given by this map. And basically, what the decision maker learned about the state, about the states, is obtained by inverting this function, which is typically is not injective. At least it need not be injective for every action. Okay, so if there is at least one action for which this function is not injective, then the state is not always observed ex post. Okay, so we can identify for a given action a set of a given observed consequence. There is a set of realization equivalent states. Okay, and when we consider all the possible consequences, we obtain an ex-post information partition. And as you see, the partition typically depends on the action taken, okay? Now, since we are considering an underlying stochastic state, actually, by keeping the action fixed, the decision maker is going to observe a distribution of consequences, okay? So basically, we use this hat notation to denote the push forward. So this is the objective distribution of consequences that is obtained once if the decision maker keep choosing action A. Okay, and therefore, so it is defined more explicitly this way. It is the standard, the standard definition of a push forward. So the point is we consider, since we are going to consider an ideal situation of a steady state that typically is not reached, in finite time. It's kind of reached asymptotically, okay? But, we consider the decision maker who is in stochastic steady state, and therefore he has an infinite data set of consequences given by a long-run distribution of empirical frequencies. Okay, gamma. So once, if the decision maker observes this distribution of empirical frequencies, he can understand something about the underlying stochastic process. What? He understands that the underlying stochastic process belongs to this set, the set of all sigma prime, such that the induced distribution of consequences given action A is precisely the observed distribution gamma. And so this gives rise to what we call the partial identification correspondence. Basically, we have a partition, of the set of stochastic models, sigma A, and the partitional correspondence is every objective model sigma give rise to, given action A, give rise to the set of all possible stochastic models that are realization equivalents to the given sigma once, action A is kept fixed. Okay. So how does the decision maker decide? Well, basically we assume that he's an expected utility maximizer. First of all, for every stochastic model and action, there is an objective expected utility that we call the reward, and we call R for reward, and it is also reminiscent of risk. This is the criterion that capture the risk attitudes of the decision maker. An important remark, which is not super important in this talk, but it is, turns out to be very important when you also put ambiguity aversion in the picture, is that this reward is constant over all the models that are realization equivalent to the given to the true model. Why? Because these are the models that give exactly the same distribution of consequences, and expected utility depends on the distribution of consequences. Okay, so all the all the sigma in this set, in this partial identified set, give exactly the same objective probabilities of consequences. So in the long run, the decision maker observes these objective probabilities just by looking at the empirical frequencies, okay? And his expected utility is just the empirical average of all the utilities that he gets, okay? And it has to be the same for all the stochastic models in the partially identified set. Okay, so what is a self-confirming equilibrium? So remember that the decision maker does not know the true stochastic models. Therefore, he holds, as a good Bayesian, he holds subjective beliefs about the stochastic model. And with this, we can define the value of action A given the belief mu. This is given by the classical subjective expected utility criterion. It is just the subjective average of the objective expected utility of the reward with respect to the weights given by the subjective beliefs of, you know, the subjective probabilities of the different stochastic models. Okay, so what, you know, in the long run, in a self-confirming equilibrium, the decision maker keeps his policy fixed. Why? Because this policy is subjectively optimal. It maximizes this subjective expected utility, given beliefs, given the beliefs he holds. And these beliefs are confirmed by the evidence, and therefore he has no reason to change these beliefs. Okay? How can we define this mathematically? Well, we consider a triple action beliefs objective stochastic model. Okay? And in a self-confirming equilibrium, the action taken is a maximizer of subjective expected utility. And this is the subjective optimality component. And the confirmed beliefs component is that the support of the subjective belief about stochastic models must be included in the partially identified set of stochastic models. Okay? Another way to say this is that the subjective belief must assign probability 1 to the set of stochastic models that give the same distribution of observations, which the one which is observed in the long run by the decision maker. Okay, so since this is a tutorial, I will not jump directly into the macroeconomic applications. I will start with an example, and then we will see, you know, how far have we gone, and, you know, I will go more or less quick on the macro application. So, example, an urn with 10 balls, okay, black, yellow, or green. And just to simplify, I assume that there are only two possible actions, bet on black or bet on white, okay? So this is, in this example, set of states is BYG, action small b, small y, meaning betting on b, betting on y. The consequences are either you don't win, zero, or you win, one, okay? We can assume that utility is just the consequence. This is not, you know, when you have two outcomes, you know, it is not very important what the utility function is. And the feedback is given by this table. Okay, so the table just says that when you know the you bet on black and the drawn ball is black, you win; otherwise, you lose. Okay, the set of possible stochastic model is the set of probability measures over these three states that are given by decimals, okay? One tenth, two tenths. Okay, so the more interesting part of the example is given by the exposed information partition. So what if the decision maker bets on black? He can only understand whether either the ball was black or it was not black. It was not black when he lost. It was black when he won. Okay, and similarly for yellow. And so how can we define the partial identification correspondence? Well, whatever the true stochastic model is, the true composition of the urn sigma is, if he bets on black, you know, in the long run, he's going to observe what is the objective probability of black. And therefore, the set of possible urn compositions is the set of compositions that give the true objective probability to black, okay? But the probabilities of the other two colors are undetermined. And similarly, if he bets on yellow. Okay, and let's see what an example of self-confirming equilibrium, okay? So it's a triple. So suppose that in equilibrium the decision maker bets on black. Suppose that the urn contains four black balls, five yellow balls, and just one green balls. Okay, this is an example of the truth. And this table represents the subjective beliefs about the urn. Now I chose to represent beliefs that first of all are uncertain. They don't assign priority one to a particular model, okay? And second, they do not even have in the support the true model, because this is not necessary for the self-confirming equilibrium concept, to have the true model in the support of the subjective beliefs. So in particular, there is probability one is assigned on this model where there are four black balls and three yellow and green, okay? Then there is another possible model deemed possible by the decision maker, which has four black balls, six yellow and zero green, and another one, four black, one yellow, and five green. Then you will understand why they all agree on the number of black balls, and because this is going to be part of the equilibrium, okay? And the probabilities are one half, the subjective probabilities are one half, one fourth, okay? So one can verify that subjective optimality and confirmed beliefs, the self-confirming equilibrium conditions, are verified. So first of all, for subjective optimality, well, the subjective value of black is actually the probability of winning with by betting on black, which is 4/10 according to the objective model, okay? So this is, this probability is identified. So, you know, it must be the case, first of all, you know, with the beliefs I consider an expected value of 4/10 is more than the alternative, the subjective expected value of betting on yellow, okay? So you can check that these are the calculations. So this is, okay, it is, I think, 16th, 40th against 13th, 40th, but I wouldn't bet on my own calculation, but it works, okay? Anyway, it works. And the support is indeed included in a partially identified set. Why? Because what the decision maker observes in the long run is that black comes up 40% of the time, okay, 4 times out of 10, and therefore, he assigns probability one to the set of models that give probability 4/10 to black. Okay. The subjectively optimal action in this particular example is not objectively optimal because according to the true model, the color with the highest probability is yellow. The decision maker can bet on yellow, and therefore that is the objectively optimal action. So in self-confirming equilibrium, typically the subjective best response is not an objective best response. Why? Because typically in subjective in self-confirming equilibrium, the decision maker or the player in games has not found out the truth, or he does not even, typically he does not even have beliefs that are in some sense equivalent to the truth. Okay, so application. So we have a macroeconomic model, a simplified macroeconomic model with unemployment U and inflation pi. So these outcomes are connected to stochastic shocks W and epsilon, okay, and to the government policy A. A is going to be the planned or target inflation. You can think of A as the rate of growth of money, okay. And so this is the parametrized form of the model economy, okay. Unemployment is given by a baseline level theta zero, plus this direct impact of inflation on unemployment, plus a direct impact of policy of unemployment. These direct impacts, according to the economic interpretations, they go through how economic agents react, okay? How economic agents react to inflation, to expected inflation, and expected inflation may be related to monetary policy, okay? And then there are shocks, okay? So theta two is the volatility, essentially. And the rate of growth of money, pi inflation, is given by the rate of growth of money plus a shock, okay? And theta three is the volatility of inflation. So just to fix ideas, okay? In the, what is the modern and by now standard simplified macro model, theta one pi is negative, and this is given, you know, by the so-called Phillips curve. Okay, so increasing inflation, at least in the short run, decreases unemployment. And in the modern model, theta 1a is positive, and it is exactly the opposite of theta 1pi. So basically, the idea is that economic agents, according to the modern theory, understand that A is going to be the average inflation. Okay. But in old Keynesian models, this was not true, and monetary policy has been set for decades according to old Keynesian models. So you can think of the most, dumb Keynesian model as one where this theta 1a is zero, no impact of planned inflation on unemployment, okay? Because, and more generally, you can think of intermediate values as, there is a fraction of economic agents is naive and doesn't understand that the rate of growth of monetary policy, basically, the rate of growth of the monetary aggregate basically sets the average inflation. And another part is smart enough to see this. And this, in this way, you can kind of justify all the possible parametrization. Okay, so we have five structural coefficients. And as I said, well, I explained what these coefficients are. So I think if there are no questions, and by the way, if you have questions, interrupt. If there are no questions, I think I can go on. Okay. So what are the states in this application? As I said, as I said before in the generalities, this is a case where we have a permanent component to the state, these parameters of the model economy, and there are these shocks, W and epsilon. So we make an assumption about the parameter space. Baseline unemployment is positive. The impact of inflation on unemployment is negative. This is a kind of the Phillips curve response. And the impact of policy on, say, expectations, and therefore via expectation on unemployment, is less in absolute value than the impact of inflation on unemployment, and these two volatilities, theta 2 and theta 3, are positive. So there is this means that there is actual volatility. Okay, consequences are unemployment inflation pairs, and the feedback function is just obtained from the previous equations of the model economy, equations 1 and 2. And it is given by this reduced form, okay? So basically, the inflation equation is the same as before, whereas in the unemployment equation, we replaced the inflation with what we get taking into account that monetary policy affects inflation, so we just replace this. Okay, that's why you have this summation here. Okay, so this means monetary policy affects unemployment in two channels: a direct channel, which is given by theta 1 pi, and an indirect channel that, in the interpretation of the model economy, is the impact of planned inflation, of monetary policy on economic agents' expectations, okay? And that's why you have this summation here. And let me remind you, according to the modern macroeconomic models, we are going to call them the Lucas-Sargent models, because they were kind of the first, in the literature. These two things cancel each other out, okay? Because one is just the opposite of the other. Whereas according to the most traditional Keynesian model, theta 1a is zero, and therefore you only have this negative number, theta 1 pi. Okay. So we assume, to simplify the analysis, that that the distribution of shocks is known. This assumption is not really needed, but it simplifies the calculations. Remember that these parameters, this vector parameter theta is fixed, okay? And therefore, the true distribution of the state is just the product of the Dirac on theta times the distribution of shocks Q. Okay. So we can, since we assume that Q is known to the decision maker, the monetary authority, we can redefine the subjective belief as a belief over theta rather than the whole S. Okay. Assumptions about noise, well, these shocks are white noise, so they have zero mean and zero covariance, and we can normalize them to have variance and equal to one. Okay, von Neumann, Morgenstern utility function says that it is a quadratic loss function. It says that ideally our policymaker would like to set both unemployment and inflation at zero. So we get a classical linear quadratic policy framework, and from this you can prove, you can prove that the expected utility is the utility of the expected values plus a constant. Okay, so you can work directly with the expected values of unemployment and inflation and feed them into the formula of utility. And this is a subjective expected utility. Okay. Now, what is the situation in the long run for a monetary authority which thinks it's doing the right thing? Okay. The monetary authority has an infinite database of observations of inflation and unemployment. Okay, so you can think of some distribution over a bidimensional space. Okay, it is an empirical distribution. Using this empirical distribution of inflation and unemployment, is trying to understand what is the true model economy. Okay. Now it turns out that in this simplified setting, you don't have to look at the whole shape of the distribution of unemployment and inflation. You just have to consider the first and second moments of the distribution in order to understand all you can about the underlying stochastic model, okay, which is not everything, but it is quite a lot. So basically, it turns out that, first of all, one identifies the this number here. Okay, this is going to be in a sense this is going to be the alpha of the Phillips regression. The Phillips regression, for those who have not studied economics, is just a statistical regression of unemployment on inflation, and data shows that statistically when inflation when inflation increases, unemployment decreases. Okay, and so basically, if you have a regression line, this is the intercept of the regression line, that it is typically called alpha. Okay, well, obviously, the fixed. Remember that in equilibrium, the monetary authority thinks it's doing the right thing, so it doesn't change the action. So this gives rise to average inflation is the action chosen always by the monetary authority. Then we have this, the variance of unemployment. Is this, so the volatility of unemployment is in the data, okay, is a second moment in the data. The volatility of inflation is another second moment in the data. And the covariance between inflation and unemployment is another second moment in the data. All these moments are observed because there is this infinite data set, okay? And this allows to recover part of the parameters of the model economy. So first of all, the most important, the beta coefficients of the Phillips regression of unemployment over inflation is this ratio between the covariance of unemployment and inflation divided by the variance of inflation. This regression coefficient is given by second moments of the observed distribution of unemployment and inflation. Therefore, this parameter theta 1 pi, the the impact of inflation on unemployment is observed. It is estimated. Okay. Then we have the residual variance of unemployment. The unexplained, unexplained by regression is given by this this formula here. Standard deviation of inflation is theta 3. Basically, what happens is that only the baseline unemployment theta 0, and this is crucial, the impact, the direct impact of policy, let's say in the interpretation on agents' expectation and therefore on unemployment, this is not, these two parameters are not identified. Okay, they remain identified in the long run, but there is only one degree of freedom in the sense that what the decision maker learns is that they must lie along a line. Okay, the line given by this formula. Now, remember the distribution of shocks is known, okay, and therefore we can prove that the set, the partially identified set with a given policy A is given by this set here. So essentially this says that effect of inflation on unemployment is identified. This is the estimated beta of the Phillips regression, okay. The volatilities are identified and the only thing is that baseline inflation plus effect of policy on unemployment times this parameter, okay, this summation, which is the alpha of the Phillips regression, which depends on the on the chosen policy, is just this summation, and therefore we have this uncertainty, with one degree of freedom. So this is the picture for two different policies, okay. There is the red is a zero inflation policy, give rise to the identification of baseline unemployment, because this is exactly, baseline is exactly the unemployment that would result with an average inflation of zero, okay. And A is the average inflation. Okay, whereas the blue line is the partial identification set with positive average inflation. Now, if you look at this picture, you may think, well, but if our monetary authority changes the policy, it finds the intersection of the two lines and it totally identifies the unknown parameter. Well, the point is that it should keep, the different policy fixed for a very long time in order to identify. So this is, we assume that this is not feasible for the monetary authority. Okay, so in a self-confirming equilibrium for this model, it is again a triple. Now we identify the model with the parameter, the true parameter vector, okay. So the policy maximizes, minimizes expected loss, okay, and the support of the belief, essentially the support of the belief must be included in the appropriate line, okay, the line in this space determined by the chosen policy. The simplest case, which is one originally considered by Sargent, is where the monetary authority has a deterministic belief about the model economy. Okay, in this case, you can reframe the equilibrium as a constraint minimization problem, because in the mind of the monetary authority, there is a hard constraint that links unemployment to inflation according to the deterministic belief about the true parameter value, and therefore you have just a constraint minimization. And if you solve the first order conditions for this constraint minimization, you recover this formula. Okay. So as you can see, the higher So the higher the chosen policy, the lower, there is a minus here, so the lower the direct impact on unemployment, okay, because if you think that by raising the monetary growth, you raise unemployment, of course you don't want to peak it too high, okay? And this is a kind of a normalization, if you want. And the beta that you see here is the estimated beta of the Phillips regression, which is given by the data. Okay, so basically these are formulas. I don't think it is particularly interesting to look at the formula, but these are the formulas that come about with dogmatic beliefs. I can anticipate that you know, if you really want to study the model and solve it, they are interesting because it turns out that those with general beliefs are really very similar. There is a kind of, basically you can replace values that are expected with, you know, deterministic beliefs with subjectively expected values in the formulas. What is more interesting is to illustrate everything with a picture. So in this picture we put, remember that with this linear quadratic model, we can put the average values of inflation and unemployment into the utility function, and that gives the average utility. Okay. So with deterministic beliefs, we said that there is a conjectured constraint. This is the green line. Okay. The green line gives the conjecture trade-off between unemployment and inflation. And you know, the usual tangency condition, and so the indifference curve is this arc of circumference. I mean, it is given that the formula for expected loss, okay? And so you have the usual tangency condition that expresses subjective optimality in equilibrium, okay? And what about objective optimality? What about the confirmed beliefs condition? Well, the confirmed beliefs condition says that the chosen, the pair given by expected unemployment, which is you know, observed in the long run, and expected inflation, which is actually chosen, this pair must lie along this line. I'm considering here the case where the true model is actually, you know, the Lucas-Sargent model. So this line says, this vertical line says, you know, in the Lucas-Sargent model there is no long-run trade-off between inflation and unemployment. And so unemployment is fixed at the natural rate and inflation is what it is. So the vertical line here represents the truth according to Sargent and Lucas. Okay, and here is a representation of what you know, a fully Keynesian monetary authority would do. And this is actually in the book by Sargent, there is also a dynamic theory of how you can converge to such an equilibrium by, you know, updating given finite samples, okay? And so in this case, a naive Keynesian believes that the observed slope of the regression Phillips curve, of the estimated Phillips curve, is also the long-run unemployment between, long-run trade-off between inflation and unemployment. And therefore you have this tangency condition is tangency between the indifference curve, the red indifference curve, and the estimated Phillips curve, okay, which is also the conjectured constraint. So in general, we have this proposition. So I don't think it is very useful to illustrate and derive the formulas, but basically, it is, in some sense, it is as if the monetary authority had deterministic beliefs. So you have the same formula, except that you have to replace subjectively expected values where you saw the deterministic beliefs about different parameters. Okay, and so this is for the subjective best response, whereas the confirmation condition can be rewritten in this way, but it is always the same, okay? So there is a one-dimensional uncertainty about these two parameters, baseline unemployment and how much target inflation or monetary policy affects directly unemployment. And basically this expressed that, the support of the belief has to lie along this line, which is determined by A star. So this is a picture when beliefs are non-deterministic, but I think I can conclude with a different one, which illustrate the case of non-deterministic beliefs with a two-point support. So it supports that assigns a belief that assigns positive probability only to two possible model economies. So let me explain this. So what do we have here along the axis? We have, so let me use this. I prefer. So basically, we have two possible models, theta star and theta, okay? Now, with each one of them determines the objective expected utility or the reward as a function of the policy. Okay? So we have vertical axis objective expected utility given theta, horizontal axis objective expected utility given theta star. Now, obviously, a given policy determines a pair of possible objective expected utilities, okay? One for model theta star, one for model theta. Now, it turns out that if you consider all the possible rate of growth of money, so all the possible monetary policies, you span this green line, okay? Now, it is important that that the set that stays within the line is a convex set, so that this line is convex toward the origin. This is important for a comment I want to make about ambiguity aversion, but let me postpone that. So what is the graphical illustration of the equilibrium condition? Well, this decision maker assigns subjective probabilities to theta star and theta, and these subjective probabilities define his subjective expected utility criterion, which give rise to an infinite set of parallel red lines. Okay, they are parallel because it is the subjective expected utility implies that they are parallel lines, straight lines. Okay. And in equilibrium, you have the tangency condition between the highest red line that intersects the green. Okay, so you have a tangency between the green. The green expresses the constraint as envisioned by the decision maker, okay, because he considers only these two possible models, and therefore this is the constraint. And therefore, you have again a kind of tangency of indifference curve given the constraint. What is the slope of the indifference curve? Well, it is given by the ratio of the two subjective probabilities of the two models. Okay. Fine. Now, to conclude. What if the decision maker, as in other work done by Tom Sargent, is ambiguity averse? He dislikes choosing policies with unknown distributions of inflation and unemployment. Well, you can represent this by having indifferent curves that are not straight lines, but instead are like this. Okay, so they are kind of like the usual indifference curves you see in economics, or maybe they can have a kink at this, which we call the partial identification line, which is the 45 degrees line. They may have a kink there, according, for example, to the Guilbeault-Schneider model. So, but let me say why this is partial identification line. Well, because remember that given the chosen policy, which is kept fixed for a long time, the objective expected utility for that policy is observed because the distribution of unemployment inflation given that policy is observed, and that determines the expected utility. Okay. So basically, it is an equilibrium condition that we have to be in this point, because if for some reason different beliefs led to a different optimal policy at a different tangency point, say like this one, basically by looking at the data, the decision maker could discriminate between these two models, or he could understand that neither of them applies. Okay, so it is only so basically, you know, having a point along this line means, you know, that the observed distribution of utilities, if you want, is actually the expected utility. Okay, so when there is aversion to ambiguity, these red lines are actually curved, and their curvature is like this. Okay, but as you can see, the tangency condition doesn't change. So in particular, if the indifference curves are smooth, as in the smooth ambiguity model of Klebanov, Marinacci, and Mukherjee, you have exactly the same tangency conditions. So you have exactly the same equilibrium conditions. So in a follow-up to this paper, we have abstract sufficient conditions that ensure that ambiguity aversion does not affect self-confirming equilibrium. When they are not satisfied, instead, you know, interesting stuff can happen. So this was, I was going back. Okay, so what about the objectively optimal policy? This is the formula. So basically, it is the same kind of formula we have seen before, with the true values, the true parameter values. And of course, the beta star is estimated. That is a parameter value that is accurately estimated. Okay. So basically, what happens is that the subjectively optimal policy A star is the same as the objectively optimal policy A, if and only if the expected value of this key parameter, let me remind you, this key parameter says how much, what is the direct impact of monetary policy on unemployment, okay? So as long as the subjectively expected value of this parameter is equal to the objective value, then the policy is optimal. So the, you may have, you know, an optimal policy even when the monetary authority does not perfectly identify the underlying model, as long as you know it gets it right on average, on subjective average. Okay, and this is the condition. And the next slide shows instead conditions for let's say hyperactivism or hypoactivism, or so either too high or too low rates of growth of the money's monetary supply. So these are the conditions, okay? So if the expected impact of policy on unemployment is less than the true impact, okay, then the guy is hyperactive, okay? If it is the same, as we said before, then the chosen policy in equilibrium is the objectively optimal one. If the expected impact instead is more than the objective impact, then you know the policymaker is afraid to choose high target inflation because he thinks he's going to hurt the economy by having a very high unemployment. In this case, the subjectively optimal equilibrium policy is below the optimal policy. And then, when does the guy get it right, gets it right in the Lucas Sargent model, okay? So in the Lucas Sargent model, there is basically theta 1a is exactly the opposite of beta, okay? Then we have this equality if and only if the objective policy is zero. So, in fact, a Lucas Sargent, you know, a monetary authority a la Lucas Sargent wants, with those preferences, wants zero inflation. Okay, so we can conclude. Well, this is the formula about the welfare loss. So this is the objective loss in equilibrium. So it is the objectively expected utility under the objectively optimal policies minus the objective expected utility under the subjectively optimal policy. Okay, it is given by this formula, so you can see that it is proportional to the square of the difference of the two policies. And so basically, this partially repeats something I anticipated before. So when there is a model uncertainty and partial identification make room for ambiguity aversion. So model uncertainty and partial identifications create a situation where there is a perceived ambiguity. Perceived ambiguity means that there is uncertainty about the true model. It doesn't mean that there is ambiguity aversion. Okay? If on top of perceiving ambiguity there is ambiguity aversion, then in principle interesting stuff can happen, but in this linear quadratic setup ambiguity aversion has no effect. So in self-confirming equilibrium the policymaker behaves, even if he is ambiguity averse, he behaves as if he were a subjective expected utility maximizer. And I explained the intuition in the previous picture, so I don't think I have to repeat this. And this is an instance of a more general result we have about the relevance or irrelevance of ambiguity aversion in self-confirming equilibrium.
Thanks very much, Pierpaolo. Yep.
Could you go back to your toy example? Because it's easier to ask the question with the urn case. That's good. So, in fact, maybe on to the next slide, where we get into one more, so where we get to the, So, just to understand what's happening here, so the reason why you're getting into this self-confirming equilibrium that's suboptimal is that you're initially thinking black is the way to go, and
okay. So if the reason is some learning dynamics that get stuck there, I did not explain that learning dynamics. Yeah. I can only tell you I can find initial conditions under which Bayesian updating leads to this.
Right. Okay, so that was going to be the question, because it does seem that the learning dynamics are going to be crucial in the possible.
Right.
And in particular, I mean, I can see how it would, the Bayesian, I mean, I can see the Bayesian story. So, so if you start, as it were, with the wrong kind of prior, then you're only generating information about black. So you're updating your beliefs about black.
It's not only about the wrong kind of prior. It's also randomness.
Right.
Because what you observe is random, and your decisions and your updating depend on what you observe. Right.
Right. So, I mean, it seems to me that in a way, it's an argument against precise beliefs, precise priors. I mean, you might take this as a vindication of the sort of imprecise view. If you want to avoid getting into self-confirming equilibria, you need to keep things imprecise.
One way to specify the reaction. We have this because we don't have enough experimentation. Okay. So anyway, let me, since you asked this, I take the opportunity to clarify something which I find really funny about economics. So in economics, we use models of subjective expected utility and Bayesian updating, and there are people, studying such models when there is uncertainty, a repeated decision problem, uncertainty like the multi-arm bandit problem, for example. And the standard result of these models is that the subjective beliefs are a martingale, and by the martingale convergence theorem they converge, but they do not converge to the Dirac on the true stochastic model. Okay? They converge to what we call a self-confirming equilibrium. This is what the theory gives. Now, what do you have in economics when instead you have multi-agent models, okay? And you look at, equilibrium of games, equilibrium of the economy. This result is completely forgotten. It is assumed that players, agent divinate, you know, the right thing without explaining how. I mean, Lucas at first tried to do this, and he gave some hand-waving explanations. I mean, kind of serious ones, but without a model. And obviously, you know, he was wrong. I mean, unless under a very special condition you could prove his claims, you know. There were two claims. One claim, people reason through the model and they solve it, okay? And this is also was, you know, the kind of explanation given for Nash equilibrium in games, okay? And the other explanation was, you know, agents learn the equilibrium. Neither of them is correct unless under very special conditions, okay? Then, yes, of course, you know, it is true that in a self-confirming equilibrium with wrong beliefs, in some sense, there must have been a lack of experimentation. Remember that when instead, you know, players are playing, you know, a possibly sequential game against other agents, it's not enough, you know, that one experiments enough. It is also the other guys must experiment enough. So the only positive results that have been obtained in the theory of learning in games have been obtained, and by positive I mean that in a sequential game you don't just want Nash, which may be a kind of self-confirming with wrong beliefs that happen to be correct along the path. They want sub-game perfect equilibrium, and the only way they can, or sequential equilibrium, the only way they can get that is by arbitrarily imposing a sufficiently high noise that make players, you know, visit every information set sufficiently often that they get the evidence. That, and I don't find that very interesting, honestly.
No, I completely accept your critical point. I guess I was trying to make a sort of more positive one, which was to say that, well, if you're a policymaker and you don't have possibility for experiment. I mean, you have very limited possibility for experimentation. I mean, you can't just fiddle around with the money supply just to see what happens. I mean, it's not politically possible. So then you have limited sort of moves you can make here. But the one thing you should not do is, you know, retain your faith in Bayesian dynamics as the only rational way of updating your belief because of precisely this.
Right. Although I find it hard. I mean, you can have a different updating that is more boundedly rational and give the same.
That would be cautious.
But even the cautiousness, you know, if you model cautiousness with ambiguity aversion.
Yeah, I mean cautiousness in the beliefs rather than cautiousness in the expectations.
Thanks. Are there more questions? No? Well, if not, let's thank Pierpaolo again.
Okay.